post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD, you certainly heard of. In the news a lot. A lot of people who go into combat-related situations experience it. A lot of people experience it in natural disaster situations. Tornadoes, we've had those locally. Hurricanes, earthquakes, tsunamis. So those are some pretty devastating experiences to people. Other examples might be personal traumas, one being assaulted, attacked, raped, robbed, beaten. Those are possible assaults. A car crash. Anything where death was a possibility for you, or where you witnessed death, or the imminent possibility of death of somebody or of somebody close to you would be a trauma. Now, it doesn't mean that you're going to go on to have a disorder, because all of us are likely to experience some type of trauma in our lives. But not everybody goes on to have this kind of a response to it. This kind of response to it includes symptoms such as avoiding similar situations. Well, that's what we saw in phobic disorder, right? So if you had been attacked on a corner, you might not feel comfortable going to that corner. You may not feel comfortable with people who look like the attacker. You may not feel comfortable in situations that resemble the situation in which you experienced your trauma, right? And problems with memory and concentration. Preoccupations, worries interfere with one's ability to think well. And so difficulties arise. Flashbacks, which are vivid relivings of experiences. Some of them can be so severe as to be dissociative, as if they are in the experience itself. But most of the time, it just is a really vivid remembering of a situation that one very much does not want to remember, does not want to think about, would like to avoid thinking of. Hypervigilance, looking out all the time for something to go wrong, looking for danger. Vigilance is good, right? Be vigilant. Hypervigilance is not being able to turn that off, even when you're actually safe. And I met a person once who was back, I believe the tour of duty was in Iraq, it may have been Afghanistan. He was just at our clinic because he was getting some testing done for job screening. He wasn't there for therapy, he was just there. And we struck up a conversation, and he's like, man, you know, there's this weird thing. I live in Elizabethton, and I'm driving around, and I can't stop looking around me at all times. He's like, I am just sitting there and I'm tense and it drives my wife crazy. What is that? And I say, well, tell me about your tour of duty. And what did he do? He drove in convoys where IEDs were an imminent possibility at all times. He had known people who were affected by explosions, and he had been in situations where explosions occurred, but not to him directly. And what he had learned, his military training had told him to be on guard at all times, because you might die at any moment, and you need to be prepared to avoid that situation. And when you go home, you don't just turn that off, right? It became a survival tactic. Now, it wasn't a big deal. He was functioning well. He wasn't complaining of anything else. His biggest problem was that it bothered his wife. She wanted him to relax and calm down. It's Elizabeth and nobody's gonna, and he's like, I know there's no bombs here. And again, frontal lobe activity. He knows that there's not a true imminent threat there, but he felt he couldn't let his guard down in a driving situation. And that's not PTSD, but to go on to higher and higher levels of suffering related to trauma, either delayed or acute, meaning it happened right after, you then start to look at diagnoses like this. And there's different kinds of treatments. The best treatment for non-complex traumas, meaning traumas that only happened once or twice, right, is exposure therapy, systematic desensitization, and just getting people comfortable with having thoughts about the trauma because they're trying to avoid those thoughts. Now, we'll see with OCD, the more you try not to think about something, the more likely you are to think about it, right? And so getting people, it's not that you make it better or you make it less painful to think about in a soulful sense, but you make it where they can stand to think about it and they don't have to avoid that thinking and they're able to get over it. But it's different for different circumstances. Somebody who lives in a war-torn country, has grown up with death as a constant possibility, or a really dangerous, dangerous neighborhood, or somebody who's on a tour of duty, because that's not just a trauma. That's not a specific situation. That's living for years in the midst of hypervigilance and trauma. So it's a much more complicated situation, and why it's much more difficult to treat combat-related PTSD. And we don't know why some people get it and some people don't get it. We have some theories, but no conclusions. You don't need to know this part right here. I just want to point out that these things are shifting. It used to be an anxiety disorder. You can imagine why. All the things I've just been describing are anxiety responses to stimuli, right? But they've moved it to a thing they're now calling trauma and stressor-related disorders because there's a very specific set of circumstances that lead to these conditions. So they've moved it for clarity and because research suggests there's more utility in considering it separately. You've heard of OCD. Having a few proclivities and eccentricities is not OCD. OCD is obsessive-compulsive disorder. And you have to differentiate that from obsessive-compulsive personality disorder, which is another thing altogether. So obsessive-compulsive disorder, OCD, is persistent, intrusive, anxiety-provoking thoughts. That's what an obsession is. You ever had one of those things they call earworm, a song in your head you really hate, and you can't seem to get it out of your head, it just keeps on going, you're like, oh, I wish I could stop thinking about that. Well, in other words, it's intrusive. You don't want it. It's persistent. It's hanging around. But eventually it goes away for most people. With the obsessions that go with OCD, they don't go away. They don't fade away. You don't just stop thinking about it. They stay persistent. They keep coming and they're aversive. People don't want to think them. Now, a lot of people worry about thoughts that they have. And we talk about thoughts not being actions, not being deeds. So the things that people think about are not necessarily meaning they're bad people. In fact, there's nothing you couldn't think about, right? There's no dream that was awful that you couldn't have, no concept under the sun, no new thoughts under the sun. Thinking things is not a bad thing. But if you have thoughts that keep coming over and over and you're uncomfortable with them and you think there may be something wrong with you for having them to begin with, or that they're just so uncomfortable you don't want to think them, that becomes problematic. Right? And you try not to think about it. Y'all don't think of a pink elephant right now. Don't think of a pink elephant. Try not to think about something, and what happens is, paradoxically, it gets more power. The more you try not to think about it, the more you're thinking about it. The more aversive it becomes. And some way you can get rid of that is to do something. Engage in a behavior, the distraction from it. Sometimes these behaviors are related to the obsessions. For example, if I had an obsession that I might get a disease from being contaminated by germs, well, that's just a normal thought for anybody, right? Or should be. We should all wash our hands every time you go to the restroom, wash your hands, or use some handy dandy stuff, right? Use some stuff. Some antibacterial stuff. Why? It's just good sanitation, right? It's good hygiene. So that you kill germs so that you're less likely to get sick. That's normal, but what if you can't stop thinking about it? What if as soon as you wash your hands, you're wondering if you got it all? Or if the next thing you touch might recontaminate you, and that the next thing you touch might recontaminate you, and you can't let go of that? Well, one thing you might do is engage in frequent hand washing, which then first serves to alleviate the obsession, right? I was anxious about the thought. That's why it was in anxiety disorders. Anxious about that thought. Well, I washed my hands. I should have fixed it. But the thought comes back. I wash my hands again. Thought comes back. Wash my hands again. And what you have is then a behavior that develops into a compulsion such that it's engaged in semi-automatically where the person doesn't feel like they have a lot of control over it. Washing your hands 5 times a day, that's probably good hygiene. Washing your hands 50 times a day, that's getting into territory that's obsessive and compulsive. When we're looking at this, compulsions take up a significant amount of time. And everybody has normal anxiety-provoking thoughts. If you leave the house and you wonder whether or not you left the stove on, it's a good idea to go back and check, right? All of us have those moments. Go back and check. But for most of us, going back and checking, go, oh, it was on, thank goodness, and I turned it off, or, oh, it was off, and no worries. That does it. That eliminates the worry because you've checked and you're satisfied. But for the person with the obsession, now they're gone. They're like, well, did I really turn it off or did I not? And so excessive checking, and sometimes it's obvious behavior and sometimes it's internal to the person. I can engage in counting, for example. I can count the lights in the room without you ever noticing that I'm doing anything unusual, right? But counting does what? Gives me something very concrete to focus on and distracts me from that obsessive thought I might be having. So the compulsions may or may not be related to the obsessions, but what you have is a chained up set of circumstances where a person is now engaging a lot of their day doing something that's maladaptive because it takes up time or causes problems in relationships or in work-related situations or school-related situations. Again, you don't need to know that for your test, but they've created a new section called the Obsessive-Compulsive and Related Disorders section because there are other types of behaviors that seem compulsive, though they aren't obsessive compulsive because they don't contain the obsession part. If they did, then you're looking at obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD.